Hey guys, so this is a very important episode because in this episode we are going to be fetching the data we have been creating all along in the admin section and displaying it in the public section. We are also going to implement the functionality to click on a post and view the details of that particular post, as well as the search functionality and the ability to view all articles under a particular topic. So let us start by displaying these articles so that they come from the database. So we start with our index.php file, and at the top here we are going to fetch all posts in the database using the select all database function. So we are going to pass the condition published and give it a value of 1. So we are fetching all posts in the posts table where the published is set to true. So we are fetching only published posts. So what we are going to do now is we'll display this array of posts on the browser and see how it looks like. So here we have our array of arrays, each of these inner arrays representing one record. Okay, so our select all function is working well. The next thing now is to look through this array of arrays and display them on the page. So down here we have an HTML element called post wrapper, and inside the element we have several hard-coded posts. So what we are going to do is we are going to take out all these posts and leave only one. So we select all of them and delete, and we leave only one post inside the post wrapper. So what we are going to do now is we are going to loop through our array of posts which we fetched up here, and for each of these arrays we'll have each individual post. So we copy this HTML, we cut it and we paste it inside the for each loop. So this display here is going to represent each of the posts. So the first thing we are going to do is let's point to the corresponding image in the images folder so that each post gets displayed with it, with the image that was created with. So we'll use the base URL constant to get to the root folder of the application, and then we'll enter the assets folder and then the images folder, as we can see here. And then inside the images folder, we will just point to the name of that image as it comes from the database. So the way our image upload worked was, we uploaded an image and then saved the name of that image in the database while storing the physical image itself in the images folder. So in order to display that particular image, we are going to get that image name from the database and then we point it to the physical image in the images folder. So this will render the image that this post was created with. The next thing we need to change is the title. So we'll pull the title from the post. We're going to leave the name for now, we'll come later on and change it. As for the date, this is the date in which the article was created. So initially the date comes in this format, just date and time, but we want to display it in a well formatted, a more readable way. So we are going to use some formatting. So we call the date function and pass the format in which we want the date to be displayed. And then as the second argument, we'll call the string to time function and pass in the date. In this case, the created at date. So when we do this, it is going to display our date in a more readable format, in a more human readable format. So this is the post wrapper and the section where we have our slider. So if we refresh our web page, you're going to see that these images at the top, these are posts at the top, are coming from the database. Of course, we have not yet implemented the ability to display the name of the user who created it. We'll come to that very soon. The next part is the recent post section. So let's scroll down, and we have a section called main content, and inside that content we have the title and then a list of posts, each of them representing one of these. So when you see a div element that has a post class, then you know that it is one individual post. So like we did up, we are going to leave only one of these posts. The rest we will delete. So let's just delete all the others and remain with just one. Now, the same way we did up here, we are going to loop through the posts. So let me just do a for each. So we will loop through the posts, and then for each post inside the array of posts, you will display, will render this article like this. Okay, the image also exists in the same folder, so the way we render it is the same as we did up here. The title as well, we are pulling it from the post variable. The date is going to follow the same format, so let me just copy it here and paste it down here. And then here we are displaying some kind of a summary of text for the content, and we are going to use a function provided by PHP called substring. And this function is going to take as first argument the body of the post, and then we are going to display from 0 to about 150 characters, and then after that we will display 3 dots to give the user the impression that more of this content exists somewhere. So if we go to our browser and we refresh, we're going to see that it is displaying the information from the database. There is a little issue here that we need to resolve, and it is these tags. So what we need to do is to use a function provided by PHP, and we call that function HTML entity decode. So we will wrap this text inside brackets, because we are invoking the HTML entity decode on it. And when we do that, it's going to decode the tags, these tags, and render our content well. So that solves the issue. So the next thing we need to tackle now is the username, to display the actual username of the user that created this post, and that is also coming from the database. Now if we display our list of posts on the browser and try to inspect each individual post, you're going to notice that there is no attribute here called username. Instead, what we have is the user ID, and we are going to somehow use this user ID to fetch the username of that user and include it in a list, in this list of attributes. So only by doing so will we be able to display the username of the user who created this post. Now, there is no way we can achieve this using the select all function, because in order to do this, we are going to be selecting data from two different tables, and our select all function only selects from one table. So what we are going to do is, we are going to define another function, another database function in our db.php file, and this function will simply name it getPublishedPosts, It is not going to take any arguments. And since it's going to be querying the database, we're going to also include the database connection object. So the next thing we need to do is write our query. And our query is going to be very similar to the regular select statement we have been seeing. But in this case, the thing that is going to make it different is the fact that we are selecting from two different database tables. So the regular select statement we are used to look something like this. So this is a typical select statement we have been used to doing. Now, in order to understand the one I'm about to write, we are just going to make reference to this. So what I will do now is I'm going to write the query, and then after I'm done writing, I will explain how it works. Okay, so I finished writing the query. Now, this query looks a lot like this simple one, so we are going to make reference to this simple one in order to understand it well. So this first simple query simply says, select all columns from the posts table where the published value is equal to 1. And this one says something similar. It says select all columns on some table which we will call P for now. Then select another column called username on some table which we will call U for now. And then after this section, the next section is a from clause, and just like this first simple query, the from clause specifies the table or tables from which we are selecting. So after this from clause, we are preceded by a post as P clause. So this simply says that select from the posts table. And the P here is simply an alias. So anywhere in this query, if you see P, you know it's a short form for posts table. So we can already tell that we are selecting all columns in the post table. So after the post as P clause, we have a join clause. So this is where we join the results of the two tables. And the join clause is preceded by users as U. So users here is a table, and as U here just specifies an alias to the users table. So anywhere on this query that you see U, you should know that it is the users table. And so far we can already tell that we are selecting all columns on the posts table, and we're also selecting the username column on the users table. And we are performing all these selects only on cases where the user ID on the post table is equal to the user ID on the users table. And we are followed by a where clause, and which just specifies that I missed something here. We are supposed to put P dot published to indicate that the published field is that of the posts table. But if there is no published field in the users table, you can still do this and MySQL will automatically know that you are referring to the published field of the posts table. Okay, so you can put it or you can leave it. I will just put it to be more specific. So one last run through this query. We are selecting all columns on the posts table. We are also selecting the username column on the users table, and we are putting these two together only on the condition where the user ID on the post table is equal to the ID on the users table, and we select only records that have been published, that is records are post whose published value is set to true. So our query is already set. The only thing we need to do now is to execute it. Now we already have places in our code where we are executing a select query. So to save us some time, I'll just scroll up to the select all function and select the part that takes my query and executes it by calling the execute query function. So I copy this, scroll down to the get published post section, and I display and I paste it here. Now our execute query function unfortunately takes some conditions in the shape of an array, but our query here doesn't take any conditions, it doesn't take any parameters. So this is an example of a parameter, and here in this query we don't have that. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to, instead of just passing this one directly, I'll just make it a parameter, and in the conditions I will specify that the published field will have a value of 1, which is true. So this satisfies the demands of the execute query function in that it sends also the data for the query. So our SQL server will now take this value and insert it here. So it's basically the same query, nothing has changed. Now with this done, we are certain that our get published post query is going to get post including the username. So I will go back to index.php, and instead of calling the select all function, I will call the get published post function. And the reason I'm able to call this without including the db.php file is because we have already included db.php inside the topics file, so that function automatically becomes available here. So I'm just going to display this post array on the page so that we can inspect it again. So if I refresh this, it fetches post again, but this time you notice that the username of the post, the username of the user who created the post, is included in that query. So what I'm going to do now is, I'll simply come down here and replace this with username from the post, from each individual post. I'll do the same thing down here. I'll replace the name here with the username. And if I refresh the browser, you're going to notice that it is displaying the username of the user alongside the post. So this is it for the display, for displaying posts in the public section. The next thing I want us to work on is the ability to search for posts in our website. The search functionality is very similar to the get published post functionality we just implemented. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to duplicate the get published post function, and I'll just give it a name, search posts, and it's going to take a search term. So this is the value that the user typed in the search form and submitted. Now the query is going to look similar to what we did in the get published post function, although there are just going to be a few changes. So I'm just going to format this a bit so that I can provide some space, just so that you can see it clearly enough. Okay, so we are still selecting put all columns on the user, on the post table, and the username column on the users table from the post and the users table, and we are joining them on this condition. But in this case, we are also going to add an AND clause where published is equal to, let's say, true, and the title of the post, let me just do p.title, and title of the post is like something. we'll just put this here. Or the body of the post. Again, let me do p.body is like, again, I do this. And that's it about the query. That's basically it. So we are selecting from the users and the post table and joining, and we are making sure that it is only published posts that we are searching for, and we are ensuring that they get only posts whose title has certain string that looks like the search term. So later on we are going to insert the search term here. So if you had a name like if you had a text like something, if you had a text like something as the title of your post and the user enters some, then it is going to look for text. It is going to get something as your text because something has in it the word some. So it has in it the word some. So I don't know if you get the point, but if you need clarification, let me know in the comment section. So because the term is a placeholder, I'll just put a question mark there. Again, the rest of the code remains the same. But one thing we haven't done is we need to add the other parameters here. We are adding the published for this particular case. So the next thing we need to add is the title, and the title will be the term, and also we will add the body, which again will be the term. So we are searching the term in the title and we are also searching that term in the body of our post. So this will be inserted here. The title will be inserted here for the title, and then the body will be inserted here for the body in that order. So our function is ready to be applied. Now we go to our search form. This is it. It is going to be submitting to the same page, index.php, and we are just going to call this search. Sorry, we'll just call it term. Well, let me just leave it search term. And our form doesn't need a submit button. So if the user enters their search term and click on the enter button, the form will automatically submit. So we are just going to receive this form submission here. We will check if the search term variable exists in the post array. Again, the search term here is the name, the value that the user entered in the input field. So if this exists, for now let us just display it on the page. So go to our browser, refresh, and this is not working. Oh okay, I made an obvious mistake. This is supposed to be the PHP global variable. So I refresh again and I search and it displays the search term. So now we can proceed to invoke our search post function. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to initialize the post variable and make it an empty array. Then here I'm just going to set, if the search term was set, it means the user is searching for posts. I will just call the search post functionality and pass in the term that the user entered. So this will fetch all posts. Sorry, this is post with S. It will fetch all posts according to that search term and put it in the posts variable, so that down here we will be displaying only those posts that have been searched. If the search term was not set, then we are just going to fetch all posts and display them normally. So let us try this. Now let us search for a word, an article that has spectacle in it. So I'm just going to search for spectacle. And there is a problem somewhere. There is a problem with our query here. And I think I know what the issue is. The issue is with our query here, and it has to do with something about this not being a string or something like that, about our use of quotation marks, of quotes. So we will probably need to do something like this, but I'm going to use a different approach to solve this. I'll create a variable called match, and that variable is going to be a string which will surround the search term with percentage signs. And then here I'm going to paste, instead of this, I'm going to paste it here and here. But then again, this is a variable, its actual value coming from a user. The only difference is that we have just surrounded it with some percentage signs. So we don't put values like this in our query directly, because we'll be making ourselves vulnerable to SQL injection security issue. So what I will do is, I'm just going to replace it with a placeholder, and this again with a placeholder. And then here, instead of putting term, I will put the match, which is like the same term, but in this case it has been modified a bit. Okay, so we are still doing, it's basically still the same query. If you take this and replace it here, you're going to notice that it's basically the same query. So let's go back and refresh, and it works. You see that we are able to select the article, the word spectacle in it. I would also like our title here to read differently. So I want the title to read something like search for, and then we add the search item, the search term, sorry. So what I will do in this case is, instead of writing the title here, I'm just going to cut this. And then in its place, I'll just display posts title. And then I go up here, I'll give the default value for posts title to be recent posts. And then here, when we search, I'm going to change the value to you searched for. And then I add the search term. Let me just make these double quotes so that here I can add the search term. So in that case, if you refresh this again, it is going to say you searched for this. Again, I will surround it with single quotes, so just put a single quote here, and then at the end you put two double quotes, and in the middle of them you put a single quote. So if you refresh and resubmit again, it now reads something better. So this is it for the search functionality. Our next feature is the ability to get posts under a particular topic. But because this episode is already too long, I'm going to leave it here for now, and then the next episode I will finish the remaining features, which is to view posts under a particular topic and to view a single post in the singlepost.php page. And in that episode also, we will finish the remaining features of the entire application itself, which is access control, that is controlling who gets access to which features. Like for example, only admins will be allowed to create posts and so on. So thank you guys for watching, and see you in the next episode.